Hello, and thank you for taking time to listen to another sermon from First Christian Church. We're glad that you joined us today as we continue our series, The Triumph of God, The Victory of God in Daniel's Life, as we continue to see how Daniel made a stand for faith in the same way that we can make a stand for our faith as well. Now, we all have hobbies. We all have things that we enjoy spending time doing or collecting. And so when we think about these things, we can see where our passions are. For myself, one of the things that I really enjoy is shoes. It's unique because as I preach, I have no shoes on currently. But growing up, I always watched Jordan and I saw all his shoes and I got really excited. It was just a passion of mine. Now I like to be able to choose and change. Oftentimes now with having kids and busy schedules, I always feel like there's only one thing I get to choose each day that's my choice and it's what I put on my feet. But whenever Jess and I were first married, we were newlyweds and we didn't have a lot of finances or means to buy really cool shoes that we desired. And so a friend pointed me towards a website where you could get Jordan shoes for cheap. Well, I found this really cool pair and I paid the $30. I know, who pays $30 for Jordan shoes? But after a few weeks, the shoes arrived and the box was wrapped in plastic, which included a force field of tape. Once I broke through the force field of tape, the integrity of the box inside was destroyed. When I finally pulled out the shoes, they were of decent quality. They looked good, but they didn't smell like new shoes. There was a strong scent of glue. Then came the wear test. Once they were on my feet, it didn't matter how good they looked because they were lacking in the foot padding. The insole was really cheap, and literally it felt like I was walking on the ground. Counterfeits is what they were. See, counterfeits have a hard time of getting things just right. From a distance, they look good, but up close, I confirmed that they were counterfeit. And I just lost $30. What we see today is how God distinguishes his kingdom from the counterfeit ones. We continue our series of Daniel, and as we see here, as Daniel wrote this book, and as we see that he was from Jerusalem, he wrote it in Babylon, showing how to live wisely in a place where God is not respected, in a culture around you where everyone else lives by a different standard or different value, and rather they see you just as an enemy or a threat. And as we learned last week, it's not just to survive, but like we learned, our goal is to have an anti-fragile faith, one that will stand and one that will endure, one that will prosper when tested. One that doesn't just continue to make way and crumbles quickly, but one that continues to thrive. Daniel chapter 12, verse 3 says, "Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever." So when it comes to living in this hostile culture, many Christians choose either assimilation or separation. To assimilate means that to gradually become and to begin to look like the culture or everyone else around you. Their values begin to become more like their values. Their lifestyle begins to imitate others. Then you have the choice of separation. Separation is the opposite. You see the world as evil, and so they come out from among after you. And so basically what you do is you separate, you flee, you run, you hide. And while even though you're acting differently, you can't make a difference in this lifestyle. Jeremiah 29:4 says, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons to give your daughters into marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase the number there. Do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it because if it prospers, you too will prosper." This verse holds so true for us. Like Daniel, we live as exiles in a hostile culture. And that's what Peter calls us, right? He calls us exiles. We're not to be hidden away just to waiting for the day for Jesus to return. We are to be in Babylon seeking the well-being of our community. As for it thrives, we begin to thrive. Well, what if there was another option? What if it wasn't just to assimilate or to separate? Because I think we're called to something greater, and we're called to transformation. So we see in our story today, Daniel and his friends live in Babylon. They speak the Babylon language, and they work the Babylon jobs. And they do as faithful servants of God. So we are called to go out into the world. And that's why Acts, there are 40 stories recorded, and 39 of them happen outside of the church. This is where God wants to demonstrate his power in our neighborhoods, in our schools, in our businesses, and in our lives. So in chapter 2 of Daniel, we see King Nebuchadnezzar walking up to in a cold sweat. He has had a dream again. Not just a dream, though. It's a nightmare. And every time he has it, he gets more and more upset. I don't know if you've ever had a repeating dream before where you're like, I've already had this dream. Well, in Daniel chapter 2, we see in verse 4, the astrologers answer the king, "May the king live forever. Tell your servants the dream and we will interpret." See, the Babylonian wise men, these astrologers, they had like this little book and they had the key to the interpretation. So everything that you could imagine was in this book. If you dreamed about an animal, they said this is what it was meaning of that dream. And so they would give their interpretations to him, but it was always in generalized terms, kind of like a horoscope, or even better yet, more like a fortune cookie. Just very general, very lax. And so when we see in verse 1, it says, "In the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled, and he could not sleep. So the king summoned the magicians and enchanters and sorcerers and astrologers to tell him what they had dreamed. When they came in and stood before the king, he said to them, 'I've had a dream and it troubles me. I want to know what it means.'" But, see, because they were just deciphering these dreams so generically, so very broad, there was no specifics. Once again, like that fortune cookie. You know, we all have had those. Your patience will be rewarded. The early bird gets the worm and the second mouse gets the cheese. The real kindness comes from within. One that would have the fruit just climb the tree. See, eventually, King Nebuchadnezzar, he grows suspect here. He says, no, these are just so bland. What is my dream about? So we see in verse 9, he says, "If you do not tell me the dream, there's only one penalty for it." So now he's gone to, instead of saying, rather than him telling him his dream, and telling them what it means, he says, "You tell me what I dreamed. If you're so smart, tell me what I dreamed. You have conspired to tell me misleading and wicked things, hoping the situation will change. So then tell me the dream, and I will know that you can interpret for me." The astrologers answer the king, "There's no one on earth who can do that," what the king asks. "No king, however, great or mighty, have ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks this is too difficult. No one can reveal to the king except the gods, and they do not live among humans." This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all the wise men of Babylon. Now, this is where we reach a point in our story here, where once again, it could get dangerous. It could get hostile for Daniel. See, the wise men truly couldn't decipher, and they couldn't tell him the dream. But the problem is that Daniel and his friends are counted among these wise men. So they potentially could be executed here in this purge as well. Verse 17 then says, "Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning the mystery so that they and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven and said, 'Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and rises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells within him.'" Daniel asked to see the king. But before he sees the king, he had a vision where all is revealed to him. He praises God in heaven. Now, that's the ultimate question, right? That everyone has. Is there a God in heaven? Is there a God? Is his power available to us here on earth? If you were like King Nebuchadnezzar, you get to the point where all human strategies have begun to fail. He's relied on these sorcerers and the magicians and the astrologers to answer his questions, to provide relief, to provide hope, to give answers. and they're not working out. And so when we begin to think about this, that's our question we have today. When we're really sitting on the fence, is God real? Is it worth my all? Should I give up to Him? Should I surrender myself, humble myself to be transformed into His likeness? That's the question. But when we begin to think about this, when we answer that question that there is a God in heaven, it changes how we see all of our problems, right? When we've tried to make relationships work, when you've tried to fix what is broken, when you feel like there's no hope, but there is good news. God is in heaven. His power starts when ours ends. When you've tried to make your kids turn out right, when you've told them everything to do to choose right from wrong, there's nothing left you can do, but God is in heaven. Have you tried to overcome addiction? You've tried to find the missing piece. You have failed so many times and time after time, but there is a God in heaven. That is where our hope is. And so for Daniel, as he's able to answer these questions, we see in verse 26, the king asked Daniel, also called Belshazzar, "Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret?" Daniel replied, "No wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the days to come." Because there is a God in heaven. Verse 31 says, "Your Majesty, look, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, and the legs of iron, its feet partially of iron and partly of baked clay." God begins to distinguish His kingdom from all of the fake ones. He begins to call out the counterfeits. There's key pieces that point us to showing us what was counterfeit and what was real. And He uses this symbolism to tell us about each part of the statue, which was made of a different substance. First, it said it was the head, which was made of gold, which represents the Babylon Empire. Nebuchadnezzar was the head of the gold. Remember, Babylon was the first superpower. It was mightier than anything else in the world had ever seen. The empire was filled with gold, and it was on its buildings and signs, its throne. It was made of solid gold. Then there's the chest and the arms, which are made of silver. This represents the Medo-Persian Empire, which helped conquer Babylon. This will take the place we see in chapter 5, but it was a reminder to us that God is in control of who is in control. You see that? Even though they might feel like they're in control, God is still in control of those who think they're in control. We have two parts of the body that are represented here, which represents the kingdoms of the Media from the north and Persia from the east. We see another part, which was the belly and the thighs of bronze. And the text isn't really super clear and descriptive as it was with the first two sections there. But what we begin to see as it continues on here, that many believe that this was the Greece, the superpower that conquered the Medo-Persia. Alexander's armies were pioneered in the use of bronze in the weapons. The Greek soldiers wore bronze helmets. Their chariots were made of bronze. Their shields were even made. Their swords, which could be explained the bronze, which symbolized their dynasty. The legs of iron, which represented Rome, the kingdom that conquered Greece. Why iron? Well, it was considered to be the strongest of all the metals. This was supposed to be the prophecy, something about Rome's strength. Scholars say that Rome took military strength to a whole new level, shown by the fact that they held their empire for several centuries. And then you have the feet of iron and clay. It was mixed. The Roman army eventually would be shattered into different kingdoms. This still hasn't happened yet because we know that there are these 10 kingdoms are still mentioned again in Revelation as part of a future event. So when he's describing this, he's using this descriptive one, God revealed to him what he dreamed, what was taking place in King Nebuchadnezzar's mind. But he also gives him a way to interpret it, that we can understand this. We see in verse 34, "While you're watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron and the clay and the bronze, the silver and the gold were all broken to pieces and became like chaff on the threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away with them, leaving a trace. But the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. In the time of these things, of these kings, we see in Daniel 2, verse 44, God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. So the rock is the kingdom of God. And when Jesus shows up in Matthew, he lets them know that they will be take the vineyard and give it to new tenants. The rock was coming. We see that from heaven, this picture of him. Think about the stone. It was made without human hands. It came about with no human agency. That the stone of the temple had to be made without human hands. This was to show that no part of God's salvation would come about by human help. No hand touched it. God would do it all. So just like the stones, Jesus would be made without human hands and was born of a virgin. The rock is also the least vulnerable substance in the dream. Granite is much less vulnerable than God. Silver, bronze, or iron. Yet this rock came with the power of God and it shattered into dust. This represents how Jesus would not come with all the bling and all the shine, but he would be part and he was born poor. He never owned a home. He never raised an army. He was no head of gold, but yet he came to a death defying the power of God. So in this dream, the rock started small, but eventually grew into this gigantic mountain that filled the whole earth. And that's what Jesus said about the kingdom in Matthew 13, that this kingdom would start small like a seed, but eventually multiply so that it covered every part of the earth. When Jesus left, you could put all of his followers into one upper room. He didn't leave an army or a fortress like Nebuchadnezzar or Alexander, yet the small movement has today swelled into this largest religious movement in history. It literally covers the face of the earth. This is the core of the message to Babylon. And what we are here to witness to today, to testify to, that God sent a rock to the earth called Jesus, who will destroy every false kingdom that was ever created by man. Whether those are large political kingdoms in the world or independent kingdoms of our own life that we build up. But yet it's not really what Jesus came for. He came first to save. He came not to judge us, but to die for us on the cross, to save us, to be a rock of salvation we could build our lives upon. But if we won't do that, then the rock will crush us. This is the choice before us today. The dream tells us what happens if you choose to oppose Jesus. Choose to receive Jesus and we will have life that lasts forever or be crushed by him. 2,500 years ago, a pagan king's dream tells you and myself about the end of history. Receive Jesus as the rock of salvation or be crushed by him. What you can't do is resist him. He came to save. Jesus said that the rock that the builders rejected became the chief cornerstone for those who had put their hope of salvation in him. The choice is ours. A life of meaning and a life of purpose, built upon a rock. All temporary kingdoms will be crushed into powder, but the one that will live forever is the one who's built upon the rock. Yes, I will.